Welcome to What's New from BBC Africa. I'm Sharihan. Coming up on today's program. A severe drought has hit the Horn of Africa. We'll have the details and hear from a teenage girl who's living through it.
Some of the girls I used to play with are still alive, but one of them died.
We head to Egypt, where a 15-year-old is using her work to challenge customs and traditions. And we meet the Ghanaian artist whose song Sugarcane went viral following a dance challenge.
We made a good product, you know, then the fans also loved it. I feel like once you market the product properly, it gets to the people and it did. Yeah.
Hello and welcome to What's New from BBC Africa. We start off the program in the Horn of Africa, where countries like Ethiopia, Kenya, and Somalia are facing a severe drought. Our reporter Simi is in the studio to explain further. Simi, what exactly is going on there?
Well, the Horn of Africa, as you've mentioned, is facing the worst drought it's seen in 40 years. Around 20 million people across Somalia, Ethiopia, and Kenya are at risk of starvation by the end of the year. It could be as bad as the drought that happened in 2011, in which 260,000 people died. In Somalia currently, entire villages are being emptied as families move to try and find food and water. And I'm talking up to 800,000 people so far. Young people are some of the most vulnerable because they could get malnourished and even die. Well, the BBC has spoken to a 13-year-old girl called Fadhosa, who told us she doesn't even remember ever having enough food to eat.
Some of the girls I used to play with are still alive, but one of them died. Some have died, whilst others have moved to the capital city, Mogadishu, where they work as housemaids. Although I was much younger, I still remember the previous droughts. Some children died because of hunger. I remember at least 5 children died. With this drought, we've lost most of our animals and left the remaining ones behind. We lost many animals in this drought. We had 3 camels which all died. We also had 9 goats, but 2 of them died.
It's terrible what's going on, and we've just seen how bad it is. Do we know what's causing the drought? Is there a connection to global warming?
Well, it's interesting you ask. It depends who you ask. Some scientists say they're not sure that the drought is directly connected to climate change. The World Economic Forum is blaming a combination of things, from the rise in food and fuel costs to climate change to armed conflicts. Scientists are saying that as long as global warming continues, though, droughts in the region are likely to increase.
And Simi, what help are people getting there?
Well, a number of organizations are trying to help. A number of charities have come together to raise money to donate to families that are suffering. The World Bank has allocated funds to Somalia's government-led program that's providing health services, aid, and water to families. The sad thing is, though, that the rainy season that usually happens in October is expected to be a dry one this year, as a drought is expected to continue well into 2023.
Thank you very much, Simi.
Thank you.
Let's head to Egypt now to meet 15-year-old Aya, who, following her father's sickness and to everyone's surprise, took up a job that's still largely considered a man's job to support her family. But what is this job, and how does it relate to her future goals? She tells us more.
I started driving the bulldozer about 4 years ago. I had to work due to my father's sickness. We needed to cover his medical expenses. Also, my sisters, they needed help in securing marriage expenses. And I have another sister who needs her study expenses covered. This type of work is considered tiresome for a girl here. People were surprised when they saw a girl working on a bulldozer. But for me, it was normal. I challenged customs and traditions, and I will continue doing this job. Clients trust me like they trust the men. I wake up at 6 in the morning and come here. We eat here. We can work until 9 p.m. When I find a little bit of time, I try to study. When my friends go to school or when they go out to have fun, I tell myself that I have bigger responsibilities.
Aya helped me in a way like no man could. She works hard to help me. I pray to God to give her strength and help her in her studies. We are not doing enough. She needs to finish high school, but she carries a lot of weight on her shoulders. I have blood cancer and heart problems, and she looks after her sisters. One of them studies in the city of Aswan. It's a heavy burden.
I have a friend called Aya Ahmed. She helps me prepare for exams. While I work, she's at school. She attends the lessons, then explains everything to me afterwards.
Look, Aya, when we were in school today and you weren't there, the teacher gave us these notes for you to revise. He asked us for the reason for your absence. We said you are working because your father is sick. He asked you to revise these notes because we have an English exam tomorrow.
I will finish my studies, even though it's a distant dream for me. I wish I can enroll in an engineering school and study mechanical engineering.
Can be hard to know what you want to do when you're older, especially if you're not passionate about any particular subject at school. Well, sometimes the clue lies in your hobbies rather than what you learn in the classroom. Many people build successful careers by doing what they love, so it's great to try a few things out, as these viewers explain.
Hello, my name is Moesha, and this is the art club. Come on in. These are my club members, and we do a variety of things in the art club. For example, this is a bead mosaic, and this is a collage. This is also a mosaic, and those two are forms of sand painting, while those members over there are doing a bit of regular drawing. As for me, I am in the art club because I would like to study animation, which is a field in art. Animation, basically, is drawing a series of multiple pictures, known as frames, and putting them through a sequence so that it creates the illusion of movement. I would like to be an animator because it sounds interesting and combines my love of art and technology. This is one of my early artworks that I drew way back in March. This is just one of the great benefits of being in the art club. You're able to express your creativity through pictures. It may not seem like much now, but in the future, you'll wow people with your creativity. If you love art, this is the club for you.
Hi there, my name is Nathaniel and this is the Garments Making Club. Here in the Garments Making Club, we students are taught how to express our creativity and develop networking skills through fashion. In this club, we make skirts, bags, mats, embroideries, and different types of stitches. I chose this club personally because I have a passion for fashion, and I believe that every student should have a skill he or she could turn to after graduating. This crop top here is made by smoking, and so we have elastic threads passed into the material to make it stretchy. And this skirt is made by pleats, so we have different pleats of little sizes here. Over here we have different types of necks. We have the V-neck, the round neck, and then we have embroidery. So we have different colors of thread passing through the material to create designs like bee mine, a bee, leaves, etc. In just a few months, garments making has been able to help me practicalize my ideas and bring out my creativity. For instance, this bag here was made by me in just a short period of time. Thanks for visiting our club.
Here in the music club, we learn to play instruments. Any instrument like the drums, yes, the guitar, even traditional instruments, you can learn to play those instruments. I want to be a performer, and music also helps in my acting, because acting and music goes hand in hand. Like musicals, they make the use of acting and music, which makes music an important club for me. So we just finished an orchestra performance, and I'm going downstairs now to join my brigade members. So we're outside, and those are my brigade members over there. We're practicing a salute. General salute. Music is an amazing club, and it's how people want to become musicians in the future. So thank you for joining us here at the Music Club. I hope you had a great time. And from all of us, we say
bye! Now, hospitals can be a scary place, and I sure don't like going to them. But one hospital in Mauritius is changing the stigma by bringing in, you guessed it, a medical clown. Sharon Jewell is Mauritius' first medical clown, and his mission is to help hospitalized children reduce stress and to make their treatment more effective. Let's go and meet him.
I just made a bubble, and then I saw that I managed to take pain and anxiety and make them disappear. When I see the kids smiling, I'm feeling really good with this, that what I do is working. It all started with a gift that my grandmother gave me. She gave me one of these juggling tools that called Diabolo, and I practiced and I became really good at it. And I moved on. In the beginning it was more conflicted because I really didn't feel, what am I doing in a hospital, till I managed to get a kid from a painful situation. I learned from my son that sometimes kids are doing things that they are very much afraid of. In those moments, if I managed to build a relationship with them before, to tell them that I love them and that they are strong, it's helping them to overcome the fear.
Having you coming here twice a week to our ward is something we're very happy about. He helps us during our ward round to relieve the stress and the anxiety of the children.
Not all kids love clowns. Some kids are afraid. That's why it's very important every time I meet a kid, I approach really gently, and I'm always checking that I have the authorization to move one step forward. If the kid is not accepting the clown, I'm staying away from him because I really don't want to make any kids stress. Some of the highest moments of me as a clown in the hospital, the psychiatrist, she came to me and she told me about a girl that is stuck in the ICU for a few months. It was a very stressful place with beep, 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 beep of machine all around. And I'm very happy to be there to help her to hold on to life and to hold on to positivity. And I'm also very happy that she is well and she's out of the hospital.
Wait, 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 wait. Wait, 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 wait.
In the hard days, what I do, I go and I talk to my wife about it. And that helps me to get up the next morning and to go there again. I would love to see more medical clowns in Africa, in different hospitals. And I hope it will do good for everybody. That's what I believe, that it helps to reduce stress, to make the treatment more effective, and in general, life better.
Bye.
Let's head to South Africa now, where a few weeks ago, 21 young people were found dead under mysterious circumstances in a tavern in East London. The victims who died were between the ages of 13 and 17. Soda has more.
This is the tavern where the bodies of 21 teenagers were found in a township in the city of East London on the 26th of June, 2022. They'd all been heading to a night out to celebrate the end of their exams. Investigations are ongoing, looking into what killed the teenagers who were found collapsed in the overcrowded tavern. With the grief, there has also been anger. Anger at the fact that the teenagers were allowed in the tavern despite all being under South Africa's drinking age of 18. The bar owner was arrested and has since been bailed. His two workers and him are expected to appear in court next month for selling alcohol to minors. South Africa's president, Cyril Ramaphosa, spoke at a mass funeral for the teens. He vowed that his government would take action to prevent alcohol from being served to children under the legal drinking age of 18.
Now, as Kenya prepares for a general election on the 9th of August, experts have noticed that social media is beginning to play a negative role. It would seem that TikTok is failing to moderate content that spreads hate speech and political misinformation during this Kenyan election period, as BBC Monitoring's Beverly explains.
Let's talk about TikTok and what exactly it has to do with Kenya's 2022 general election. The app is the most downloaded social platform in Kenya and is popular among 16 to 24 year olds. But how it's being used by supporters of various political factions is raising questions.
Win.
These two, William Ruto, Kenya's deputy president, and veteran politician Raila Odinga, want to be the country's next president. Their intense rivalry is spilling over onto social media. According to research, some of the most dramatic disinformation is spreading on TikTok. Data journalist and Mozilla Foundation fellow Odanga Madung has researched the issue.
It's gone from barely existing in the past 5 years to, you know, being this juggernaut in this election. One thing that is more perhaps dangerous about TikTok is that I do not need to build an audience in order to go viral. It's the same thing that allows dangerous political misinformation to thrive on the platform.
So what are people seeing? There has been a lot of political jokes, but they're often based on ethnic stereotypes that trivialize issues and could entrench animosity. Messages of hate, as well as speeches targeting rival ethnic communities and social groups, have been freely used on the platform. Clips like these can easily be found on TikTok, though it's hard to know who put them there and for what purpose. Each candidate has accused the other of inciting violence to intimidate their supporters. But both have also condemned the use of violence in politics and apologized for instances of violence, and recently pledged to conduct peaceful campaigns.
A very clear goal of the disinformation apparatus in general has always been to erode trust, whether it's in candidates, the electoral process, or any other part of what it means to engage democratically.
There are concerns that disinformation could particularly affect Kenya's young voters. People under 35 make up 75% of the population, and the number of people of this age who registered to vote in the 2022 election has dropped by more than 5% compared with the last. But TikTok is not unique among social platforms.
There's no social media platform that eventually does not lend itself to political purposes.
And there's the question of whether social media companies are doing enough to combat disinformation.
The platforms themselves have the biggest role in ensuring that they're not contributing to a polluted information environment, because they are the holders of the black boxes that are the algorithms. They have all the data.
Meta and Twitter say they have measures to deal with disinformation. TikTok says it's committed to protecting the integrity of its platform and has a dedicated team working to safeguard it during the Kenyan elections.
And finally, from TikTok in politics to TikTok in music, Ghanaian artist Camidoh gained international success after his song Sugarcane became a dance challenge across social media platforms and topped multiple charts in Africa and other countries. Stefania went to meet him.
People feel like I sound Nigerian a lot, but I'm Ghanaian, like by birth. Like
Kenya, yeah. It's no doubt in that.
Yeah.
What would
so
you say?
My native language is Ewe.
Ewe.
So
okay.
I'll say Efwa.
Efwa.
Yeah, that means how are you? Alekinyagbea.
Okay.
How's life going for you?
You are the sugarcane hit maker. This single has been on top charts in Africa and across the globe. What has made this song so successful?
Well, first of all, I think it's the fans. We made a good product, you know, then the fans also loved it. I feel like once you market a product properly, it gets to the people and it's consumed. Yeah.
Definitely.
Yeah.
And I've seen that there's this dance challenge going on.
Yep.
It's trendy. It's been on TikTok, Snapchat, Instagram.
Yeah.
I mean, who came up with it?
Two ladies basically came up with a particular dance, a different, like totally different from what we brought. And then they created a whole different dance to it. And when I saw it, I was like, ooh.
Okay.
You know, like it started going viral. That's why, one of the reasons why I don't play like no platform like low. Do you know what I mean?
I see. There's potential in each every platform.
Yeah. Thank you. I think that's like the simplest way to put it. I wanna teach
your body a thing or two. If you know the things you... Why did you choose the artist for your remix?
Like I said, I wanted to do a remix with Mayo Cohn from Nigeria. And for some reason, Favor found me. Where Kim Promise reached out and said, hey, I'm loving your new record. If you ever want to do a remix, I'm ready for you. You know, same way Dako also reached out to a friend and said, hey, I'm loving your record. It's even in my playlist. And, you know, I'm down to, you know, jump on it for a remix. So I just saw that as a blessing as well.
We recently saw you on this Ghanaian TV show called Date Rush.
Date Rush.
Date Rush.
Right.
Is there a person, is there someone sweeter than sugarcane?
Yeah, I'm in a relationship.
You are?
Yeah, I am.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
I mean, like behind every successful man, there's a woman. I think that my default, like go-to topic is love. I grew up in a space where there's like loads of ladies.
Okay.
My mom was a teacher in a girls' school in Ghana, and I hear their stories like, you know, love, heartbreaks, all of these diverse type of like love situations with ladies. And also because I first got inspired by Akon to start making music, I have that like R&B foundation.
What is the one message you would like to give to our young people?
Be yourself.
Yeah.
You can't create what isn't another person. What is in your belly is what you need to bring out. Beth, what is in you? This is the time for you. Love your life.
That's all from the BBC What's New team this week. See you next time. Bye.